I'm here on behalf of United Methodist Women, and each year we honor our graduating seniors. May has been a fabulous month. If you remember, on May 2nd, we confirmed and baptized 12 middle school age children. On Mother's Day, we welcomed 6 babies into this congregation, and today we honor 12 graduating seniors. It's a good month. Seniors, the United Methodist Women wants you to know that we are proud of you. This is your church home, and it will always be your church home. This particular church was founded in Leesburg 147 years ago, in 1874. We've been on this block of land for the last 127. We're going to be here when you come back. We just want you to know it. Pandemics, tornadoes, floods, it doesn't matter. We're staying here. And God wants you to know that you are part of our family and always want to be, will be a part of our family. I'm going to share with you my favorite scripture for graduates. It's Jeremiah. Well, hang on. Did I hit something? Okay, there. 11 through 14. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me, and when you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from when I sent you into exile. So welcome back from the exile of the pandemic, and we are happy to have you. I have a little token of our love and appreciation for you. I'm going to call names. When I do, come up here and receive this, and so the congregation can see your lovely faces. First, Jacob Carlstrom. If you want to stand over there. If you'll stand over here, thank you. And Victoria Drury is not with us. Janie Eubanks. Thank you, Janie. Cameron Foyt is not with us. Carlin Gary. Abigail Haggerty is not with us. Jacob Hoover is not. Sammy Hoover. Thank you. Chase Howell. Congratulations. Trista Karst. And Maddie McMickle. And Isabel Quinn, who is not with us. Congregation, please help me congratulate the class of 2021.
And we have one more who's up there. Mackenzie, if you'll stand. I don't know how we left you off, but we don't want to leave you off. There she is. Do we have anybody else that we unintentionally left out? Anybody? Anybody else?
I thought I might forget, so I brought.
You're good. So we have some college graduates, right? Cara's going to graduate with her associate's degree. Right there. Stand up, Cara. Let them see you. That's a big deal. Do we have any other college graduates here with us today? All right. When you start getting people, you don't want to leave anybody off. So, all right. Well, I want to just say a special prayer for all of our seniors, okay? Let's pray. Lord, I'm thankful for these young men and women. And Lord, I just am thankful for the high school experience that they've had, their whole education. And I pray everything that they've learned, that they've been given in way of memories, would stay with them. And as they kind of leave the nest, I just pray, Lord, that you'd be with their moms and dads, that you would be with them as they take the next step, wherever that step leads them. Lord, most of all, I pray they would never venture too far away from you, and they would always have a place that they could call a church home, whether it's at the college they're a part of or whether it's back here. I pray they know they have a place that they can go to be connected to the body of believers. May that be so in all of their lives. Keep them safe. Guide their steps, we pray, in your precious name. Amen.
I'll tell you, most of us probably remember graduation in our lives. And, you know, it's not the end. It's just the beginning of a new adventure in life. Of course, always remembering to take the Lord with you where you go. And this particular song that we're going to do this morning, this hymn, it says what we ought to do. And it says, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Let's stand as we sing. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing blood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, all for grace to trust Him. Precious Jesus, all for grace to trust in Him.
And of course, that scared me to death. And so she got there, and we got in the van and went to the emergency room, and Donna picked up Ben. And so she's been in the hospital since yesterday afternoon. I'm thankful that when the preacher's kind of out of pocket worrying about his family, I'm not alone in that. You guys reached out and prayed and talked to Krista, and I just thank you so much for doing that. There were people who kind of picked up the slack on things that I would normally do myself, and so I'm just appreciative for the way that works. I don't like Facebook for the most part. I think it's can be more trouble than it's worth, social media in general. But I am thankful that you can put a prayer need out and you have 150 people praying immediately. I'm thankful for Facebook in that regard. We felt your prayers, and I want to just thank you for praying. She's home. Her blood pressure is under control now, and so she'll probably be moving forward taking that for the rest of her life, but that's okay, right? I know we have other people that we're praying for that are in our hearts and lives. I want you to remember Patty Wiggins. She's going to be starting chemo this week coming up, so we remember her. Pray that goes well. That starts Tuesday, and just cover her. And we got other people that are going through certain things. Surgery's coming up over the next month. Family members who've had tests, and those test results have come back. And we just want to cover everybody who's in our prayers to God. There's two more that I want to just lift up, and they're unspoken needs that have been given to me. And to pray for those unspoken needs too. You don't know what they are, and that's okay. God does. And so when you lift up those unspoken to Him, you're praying for that need, if you'll remember them as well. Let's have a moment of silence as we gather our thoughts together, and together we'll lift our prayers to God as we pray this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne, I just want to thank you for the way you show yourself to us. I know for me and my family, you showed us who you are and who we are in a mighty way. And you used the body of Christ to do that. People reaching out, people praying, comments made to lift us up. And I'm just so thankful for the body of Christ and how you used the body of Christ to lift us up in those times when we're in need. Father, I'm thankful that there's not one thing that we go through in this life that you don't know about. And in fact, whenever we go through these troubling, difficult times, you're there. Remind us of that, God. Remind us that we are not alone, and that you will never leave us or forsake us. Lord, we pray for peace, to be present in all of these who are on our prayer list. Lord, you know each person, the need they have, and we just ask for peace, that you would calm hearts, that you would just encourage and lift up and remind them that you are with them, whatever it is they're going through. Lord, I know there are so many going through physical things that need a healer, need a great physician today, and you are the great physician, and you are still in the business of healing. Whether you use doctors, chemo, whatever, Lord, you're still in the business of healing. And so we ask for healing for those that we love. Lord, we just ask that you would work in these circumstances and that you would be lifted up. God, we're thankful for this church that we're part of, this family of believers. We ask, God, that you would continue to strengthen our bonds together and that you would use us in a mighty way for your kingdom's work. Lord, I don't know what you have in store for us, but I know you have something. I know on the other side of this pandemic, there's going to be a great work to be done in every community all across this globe. So, Lord, prepare the church to do what we've been called to do. Prepare Leesburg United Methodist Church for what you've called us to do. Open doors for us to walk through of ministry that we need to be a part of and give us everything we need to accomplish those tasks. Lord, we love you. We thank you for loving us. Be with us in the rest of this service. Open our minds to understand as you speak to us, our ears to hear you clearly, and our hearts, Lord, to feel your presence. All these things we pray in your Son's name. Amen.
As we continue to worship this morning is Pentecost Sunday, And one of the things that we often forget is really inviting the Holy Spirit into our presence, because He's here. And as we sing this worship song, it's called Holy Spirit. Let's worship together as we stand and as we sing.
Presence, Lord. And fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
And you may be seated.
Let's pray. God, in a very real way, I want to ask that your Holy Spirit would fall on us here. That the Spirit in us would wake up. And that in these moments, you would speak to our hearts and lives. There's no other moment in the life of your church and the faith of believers than the moment that the Holy Spirit came to us. So, Lord, in this moment, speak to us again of the anointing and the power of your Holy Spirit and why it is so important. As we come up out of this time of sheltering, prepare us, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. So last week we talked about Ascension Sunday, and we've been dealing with this idea of sheltering. Jesus told the disciples, I'm going away and I'm going to prepare a place for you. He's told them that. He's told them of a helper that would come. We read that in the Gospels. And this helper would come and be a source of strength, counseling, teaching while Jesus is gone. And so now Jesus is about to send into heaven. We talked about that last week. And Jesus says, go to the upper room and wait. Acts 1:8 says, you will receive power. You will be made my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the outermost parts of the earth. So all that has been said. So they go into their time of sheltering, and then chapter 2 comes. There is always a moment of sheltering, but there's always a moment where we come out. For the Christian, that moment is the pivotal moment. Remember last week I told you they went to that upper room, but this time they did not lock the door. This time they were not afraid. This time they were not scared. This time they were waiting on God to do something big. I want you to know I am waiting on God to do something big. We have come through this time of sheltering in place. We've come through this time of waiting for God to do something. I am telling you, throughout Scripture, any time there was this time of sheltering, when they came up out of it, there was something big that took place. I am counting on God to do something big for the world with this church as we come up out of this pandemic. Now, I know we're not out of it yet, and I know there's other countries that are still kind of in the deep of it. But for us here in America, it seems to be getting closer and closer to that time. Are we ready, church? Are we ready for what God has in store for us and the things He has for us to do? So let's look at Acts chapter 2. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 13. We're going to kind of work through it. Let's look at it. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. All right, let's stop right there for a moment. How many of you remember the hurricane that came through? Do you remember the wind? Do you maybe remember the way it sounded? Right? Probably a lot worse than that, but it was something like that. And so it blows through, right? Can you imagine that wind being held in one little room? That was outside. We saw it. We heard it. We saw the trees shaking. You remember the eye of the storm coming through and then everything getting quiet. And then everything kind of picking back up again on the backside. That in this room is the wind that we can just think about. This is the Holy Spirit coming. This is a noise that is being heard, not just in this room, but in this community, in this area. And so this is what's taking place. Let's continue in chapter 3, verse 3. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. And they were filled all with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with one another's tongues, begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterances. And so the Holy Spirit falls. They're still in this time of sheltering. They haven't left this yet. And the Holy Spirit comes. The wind is rocking the place. And then all of a sudden, we see fire on top of their head. Now, I want you to know today that you still have that fire on top of your head. Because the Holy Spirit is in you. If you've asked Jesus Christ to be Lord and Savior of your life, the Holy Spirit is in you. Now, this was the first time it had ever fallen. And so, boom, it's up there. All at once, everything Jesus said in Acts 1:8 is coming to pass. I want you to go and I want you to shelter and I want you to get ready. You're going to know when the time is right. You're going to know when it's time to move. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. This moment is now. The Holy Spirit has fallen. And the power is being seen in the mighty wind that is blowing in this room. And then the appearance of the flame. But not even so that as they begin to start speaking in other tongues. Now this is not unknown tongues. This is not angelic language. This is Spanish, Latin, French. I don't know if they were speaking French or not, but it's that you get my point. It was languages that they did not speak, they began to speak. The power of the Holy Spirit is being revealed through the way God is using his men and women. God wants to use you and me in the same mighty way. This pandemic is going to come to end. I believe that. And I believe the other side of that is going to be a great awakening for the church. It is going to be a moment when God uses his church, maybe for the last time before he returns in all of his glory, to share the good news with as many people as we can before he returns in all of that glory. What that looks like, what it's going to be, I have no idea. But I just feel it in my heart. Whenever there's been a moment like this, a modern moment that we're living in, God does something big. And I think he's going to use his church to do it. Let's continue. Verse 5. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were bewildered because they were each one hearing them speak in his or her own language. And they were amazed and marveled, saying, why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? Why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that each hear them in our own language to which we were born? Perinthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygian and Pamphylian, Egypt, and the districts of Libya and Cyrene, and the visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them in our own tongues speaking the mighty deeds of God. I mean, does that not give you chills? Do you see what just happened? They moved from the upper room. Sheltering is over. When God does something big like this, it's not contained in a room. It is moved out. Sheltering in place is done. God is now starting to use his church to do something big. This is the spread of the gospel. Listen to all the people who heard the good news. From Egypt to Asia, people were hearing it spoken in their own language. And I can tell you that these men didn't know those languages. But what I want you to understand today is God is going to use you to speak in different languages. That may not be Spanish, French, but it could be a language of occupation. It could be a language of sports. It could be a language of just things that you know. God uses information that we gather, and we may think it's useless. But it becomes the very thing God uses us to speak to other people's hearts. For them, it was their language. They knew who these men were, and they knew they did not speak other languages. But yet, they're doing it. I remember sitting for 2 hours listening to somebody talk about fiber optic phone lines. That was the worst conversation I think I've ever had. I didn't say that to the guy because he really digged fiber optic lines, but I was like, this is so boring. But I remembered it. And you want to know that probably a year later, a guy started talking to me about fiber optic lines. I was like, I know all about it. And that led me to be able to talk to him about faith and other things. Something I thought was useless. I mean, I've been a pastor now for over 15 years. And let me tell you, I've been in hospitals, in hospital rooms, and the doctor will come in and I'll try to ease out and they'll say, no, stay in here, preacher. So I stay in and I've learned about medical procedures. I've learned about all these different medical things. So when we were in the hospital this week, the doctor was talking, I said, oh yeah, I know all about that. And they, are you a doctor? I said, no, I'm a pastor. And the guy's, oh yeah, I bet you do know a lot of these things. I mean, I've seen pictures of people's medical stuff. I'm like, I don't need to see that. But they're like, okay. But I've learned. Listen, you may live here in the state of Georgia and be a fan of the Pittsburgh Steelers. Got any Pittsburgh Steelers fan? Well, I think we got one. But you're thinking nobody could be Pittsburgh Steelers fans here, but that may be the very thing that opens a conversation for somebody you just met. Oh, you're a Steelers fan too? So am I. It's a language, whether you know it or not. It is a language. Music is a language. For you who are part of being involved in music, God may use you to share the good news using this language. We're coming up out of this pandemic. What has God taught you that God wants to use in you to speak to people? We're in an agricultural place. Those of you who speak farm language, let me tell you, that's a language that you can use as an avenue to share the good news. Why is this so important? Why was it so important that these disciples spoke in other languages? Because the people were asking questions. Look at verse 12. And they all continued in amazement and great perplexity, saying to one another, what does this mean? Man, this whole chapter boils down to that question. What does this mean? There are people that you come in contact with every single day that are asking the question, what does this mean? What does this pandemic mean? What is the church doing? What does this mean? Why are you being able to handle a diagnosis of cancer the way you do? What does this mean? Has there ever been a more important question than that question? As we come up out of this pandemic, people are going to be asking that question of you, whether you're in high school, junior high, whether you're retired, that question matters. And there are going to be moments when you're asked that question that you can't say, here's my pastor's number. You've got to answer the question. Are you ready? Are you ready? What does this mean? Man, God has shown up in a big way. They've come up out of the shelter in place, and they are speaking the good news in a language that they understand. And they are hearing it for the first time. And these people are going to go back to their places where they live. And they need to know the answer because they've got something to share in their communities. And the good news is the disciples had the answer. Why do we know that? Because the gospel spread like wildfire after this moment. But what are you going to do when they come to you and ask that question and you don't have an answer? What does this mean? How can you handle things the way you do? What's different in your life that's different in my life? Because I'm not getting the same thing you're getting. I see your life and it's so much different. What does this mean? Now, I'd love to tell you that everybody's going to handle their fear that way. And this is kind of that moment. Now, these people, and there's a bunch of people gathered around. They've heard this wind. They've heard this ruckus going on. They're gathering. You know, you've seen it, right? There's something. Half the time when you go on the interstate and there's a big line holding up traffic, you get there and there's normally somebody changing a tire or something, right? But everybody has to slow down to see what's going on, and so that backs up the whole interstate. Have you ever been on, you better have waited an hour for somebody to. So crowds gather, they want to see. And so this is a big crowd. Now, some of these folks are asking questions. What does this mean? That's how they're handling their fear. That's how they're handling their uncertainty. Other people handle their uncertainty by going a different route. Listen. They say in verse 13, but others were mocking and saying, they are full of sweet wine. Now, there was a time when I was not a Christian, right? And that was in high school. And I've had sweet wine before. Just going to confess that to you. But there's never been a time in my life where sweet wine has made me speak Spanish. I can tell you that. Not coherently in any regard. Sweet wine doesn't work that way. Like being drunk doesn't make you do crazy things like speak different languages. There's only one anointing, one power where that comes from, and it's from God. So these people, whether they're uncertain of what's going on or whether they're scared to death, some are asking questions, some are making fun. But as if to complete God's promise, you receive power and you will be made my witnesses. If there was ever a moment when Peter would have a long stack of witnesses, it was this moment. Listen to what happens in verse 14. We're not going to read Peter's sermon, but Peter gets up and preaches. But Peter, taking his stand with the 11, raised his voice and declared to them, men of Judah and all you who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give heed to my words. You will be made my witnesses. Peter is about to do something difficult. This is Peter. I don't know him. I've never met him. Doggone it, I don't know him. Remember that Peter that denied Christ 3 times? This is Peter that said, hey guys, Jesus is dead. I'm going fishing. Remember that Peter? Peter, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord. Feed my sheep. Hey, Peter, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord. Feed my sheep. Hey, Peter, do you really love me more than these? Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Feed my lambs, Peter. This is the Peter. The bull in the china shop. The Wreck-It Ralph. He's the one that stands up and says, hey, men of Judah, all you, listen to what I'm about to say. And the gospel was preached for the first time since Jesus' ascension through the power of the Holy Spirit. So what happens after the sermon? Well, let's look. So his sermon ends in verse 41 of chapter 2 says this. So then, Those who had received his word were baptized, and there were added that day alone about 3,000 souls. So they come up out of sheltering in place, filled with the Holy Spirit, ready to do what God's called them to do. Hear the question, what does this mean? And stand up and declare, this is what it means. I'm going to challenge you to read verses 14 through the end of chapter 2. I want you to hear his sermon to the people of that day. I wish we had time to go through it all, but we don't. Today, this is what I know. This pandemic, I believe, is coming to an end. We're not there yet, but I think we're getting there. Things are opening up. More things are opening up. And it seems like we're coming to the light at the end of the tunnel. Are you ready for what God has in store for you? Are you ready? Seniors, are you ready? I know, it's scary, isn't it? But let me tell you something. It is scary. I can remember being a senior. I can remember thinking, man, this is cool. But behind me saying this is cool, there's a part of me going, I am scared to death. I'm about to jump out of a nest that I've been in for 18 years. What is this going to look like? Now, I'm not saying mom and dad were like, get out. You gotta go. They were still there. But I knew it was time to fly. But this is what I want you to hear as we close. Did Peter get up there by himself to preach that sermon? No. Did you catch what was said in that verse? But Peter, taking his stand with the 11. Isn't that a powerful picture? Can't you just see Peter and then they're all got their hands on him? Can't you just see him behind him, holding him up? Listen, I know every single Sunday I get up here, I've got seven brother pastors who have prayed for me and have their hand up as my hand is up for them. I know there are those of you that pray for your preacher every single Sunday. And I know your hands are up. I want you to know, every time you go into the food pantry and you do the ministry you've been called to do, your pastor's behind you holding his hand up. Every time you go to the doctor for chemo or hear what your preacher is standing behind you holding you up. But not just me, the church. We are not alone. We do this together. You are not alone. You do this together. Listen, I knew no matter what happened to Krista at the hospital, God forbid the worst, I was not going to be alone. I had my church, my friends, my family, the body of Christ pushing me, holding me up. The good news is God is going to use us in a mighty way. And I know there's going to be times you're afraid, but you're not alone. Right? Seniors, you don't just need to know that. All of us need to know that. God has something in store for us, and I can't wait to see what it is. The question is, are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready to answer that question? What does this mean? Well, let me tell you what it means. What does this mean? I'm here to help you. God wants to use you in your family. He wants to use you in your work. He wants to use you in your school. He wants to use you at Walmart. He wants to use you at the doctor's office. He wants to use you anywhere he can. Are you ready? For them, sheltering place was over. The word of God was out. Have you ever been lighting a fire? Maybe you had a barrel where you're burning some trash, or maybe you were had a, you know, a wood pit that you were burning. You were sitting around. Maybe it was dry and some sparks shot out and got the ground on fire. Have you ever noticed how dry grass burns? You can see the line, can't you? It's a burn. It's a little burn line, and it starts going. When the Okefenokee Swamp was on fire, it was a burn line that was massive. Those pine trees were dry, and it would foom, foom, foom. I mean, they would just light like a match. And they would go. I remember driving on the way to seminary and seeing it just blazing on either side of US 1. And one firefighter told me that it jumped US 1 from one side of the thing to the other. That is a massive thing that was so difficult to control. The Holy Spirit is a massive thing. And we spend all of our time trying to control it when it never was meant to be controlled. If we would let go and let God use it to move us, there's no telling who you might impact. There's no telling what you might do. There's no telling how God might use you to answer the question, what does this mean? My prayer for you this week is that God would put people in your way that are asking the question, what does this mean? And you can look at them with all the love that Christ has, and you can share the story, using the languages that God has given you to meet them where they are. Amen? As we close out our time together and as the praise band comes forward, I want you to know we walk in grace, right? There's always times when we fall on our face in this walk that we have. Any of you fell on your face before? Yeah, I think everybody's shaking their head. I know. I've fallen on my face several times. Sometimes you think you got it and you don't, right? Well, there's grace, and grace is always present. Seniors, grace is always present. There can be times you mess up. It's okay. Trust God. He'll get you through it through His grace. The Holy Spirit wants to move in you, church. Will you let it? The invitation is simple. As we sing this final song, I want you to let go of anything that would hinder the Holy Spirit from moving in your life. I want you to take off any chains that you have keeping it back. Maybe you got bungee cords keeping it from falling. Let that closet open and let all the junk come out so that the Holy Spirit can do what it needs to do. You hear me? So my prayer for you, and this is the prayer I want you to pray. Holy Spirit, you're free to do whatever you need to do in my life. I'm letting go of all the boundaries. I'm letting go of all the things that would hold you back. Use me. Use me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to this time of invitation, I echo what I just said. Use us. We are opening ourselves up to you. Lord, you use these disciples in a mighty way. They came out of their time of sheltering, and they did just what you said they would through the power of the Holy Spirit. That same power that is in them, was in them, is in us. We can see you do amazing things in this age through us, your church. And in fact, we ask that, Lord. We are ready. In your precious name, we pray these things. Amen.
Sin and darkness, it's so high, it's so much stronger. amazing grace. This is amazing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing all that you've done for me.
I'm going to ask the McMichaels if you'll come forward. I want to pray for y'all. They're going to, this is their last Sunday with us. They're going to be moving to Texas. And then I'm going to ask seniors if you would stay up here after the service is over. I want to take pictures of you up here. Mackenzie, you come down, okay? You don't have your robe on. That's okay. You're going to come down, all right? All right. We love the McMichaels, right? And we're going to miss you guys greatly. But we want to send you off. Jeff was asking me, do we automatically take him off the roll? And no, we're going to keep him on and reluctantly take you off when you join another church. But it better be a good church, okay? One that loves you like us, all right? All right, so let's pray for them and just cover them as we close out our time together. We're going to miss you guys, but we always know where we can stay if we go near San Antonio, right? All right, let's pray. God, I just thank you for the McMichael family, and I just thank you so much for these girls that we've seen grow up. Lord, I hate saying goodbye. And I know we're not saying goodbye because we have an eternity where we'll be together forever. But I know you move and you work and they're going back home. And I'm thankful that they're going to be blessed being close to family. I just pray you'd go before them. You'd help them, Father, find a church family that would be a special place for them to continue their spiritual journey. And Lord, that you just cover the girls and the schools that they're a part of, and that their life would just be blessed. We love you, Lord. We're thankful for this time that we've had together. Thankful again for these seniors. Lord, I just pray your hand will be on them as they travel in this great big world. You cover them and keep them safe. Lord, help us to remember we all have the Spirit in us, and you've called us to use it in a mighty way. May we do so. All these things we pray in your Son's precious name. Amen.